Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2024. And our first item this morning is the customary item to invite colleagues to agree to take agenda item 4 in private, where we'll consider our approach to the draft report into our inquiry into the A9 duelling project. Are members content that we do that?
Agreed.
We are, thank you. That brings us to agenda item 2, which is the consideration of continuing petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1885 to make offering community shared ownership mandatory for all wind farm development planning proposals. This petition, lodged by Karen Murphy, the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make community shared ownership a mandatory requirement to be offered as part of all planning proposals for wind farm development. We last considered this petition on the 25th of October, when we agreed to clarify what power the Scottish Government might have in relation to mandating community share ownership, CSO, through the devolved power under the Electricity Act of 1989. The Minister for Energy and Environment has confirmed that in the Scottish Government's view, any legislation relating to how consents for electricity generation stations are granted would be related to a reserved matter, putting it beyond the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. The submission highlights the onshore wind sector deal, which is described as a collaborative commitment to develop practical approaches to support and encourage CSO models, and it aims to assist developers, funders, local government and communities to engage with CSO opportunities. A framework is due for publication by the end of this year. Now, in response to the Minister, the petition submission reiterates her view that industry will ignore the Scottish Government's plans unless CSO is made mandatory. She reiterates her main call, which is for CSO to be made mandatory through the use of devolved local land and tax powers. The committee also asked for an update on the work being undertaken by the Scottish Government, Scottish National Investment Bank, Local Energy Scotland, communities and developers. The SNIB's response outlines that work includes assessing the scale and level of interest at a community level, developer considerations, how to best cater for community engagement on complex financial transactions, and the current appetite within the private sector to fund shared ownership models. So quite a lot of response and material to consider. Do colleagues have any suggestions for action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider writing to Minister for Energy and Environment to ask what progress has been made on exploring the possibility of utilising tax powers to mandate community shared ownership in renewable energy developments as indicated by the Minister.
Fergus Ewing.
As well as adopting Mr Torrance's suggestion when writing to the Scottish Government, could we also ask them if they've reached a conclusion on the matters set out in their submission from the Minister of Energy and Environment last November, where they said that the officials are currently developing policy proposals for inclusion in the final strategy, informed by the consultation that will build on the success of CARES, which is an acronym for the organisation that deals with community renewables, our existing good practice principles for community benefit and shared ownership of onshore renewables. I had suggested in the previous session's convener that community ownership can be obtained without developers necessarily making financial contributions themselves in addition to their current community benefit payments, which are normally at the tariff of £5,000 per annum per megawatt. But in addition to that, they could be persuaded to add community turbines to wind farms, for example. So instead of having 18, you could have 20, and the SNIB could fund a loan of most of the capital required to purchase the additional turbines. And that's a model which I sought to pursue when Energy Minister and was successfully pursuing until the abrupt cessation of ROCS rot. And I won't go into that. But this was being funded by private banks, Triodos, Close Brothers and Co-op Bank. And I really would like the Scottish Government to be asked to address this and if they will include this particular proposal in their plans. And finally, In addition to that, there will be an incoming UK government, and it would seem to me that the petitioner would very much want the Scottish government to collaborate with the incoming UK government, whatever hue it may turn out to be, in order to make up for the lacuna of lack of legal powers by agreement to further community ownership. So I think this is really, really important issue for rural Scotland, or many parts of rural Scotland who feel that the benefits are passing them by to developers and they're not getting a fair share. And I do think that, I'm sorry to go on about this, but it did work before. Why haven't they addressed this? Are they considering it now? If not, will they do so? And if not, why not?
Just to be clear, are we inviting the Scottish Government to work with whoever the next government is, or are you asking this committee to write to whoever that next government is
on the issue? Well, in the first instance, we should ask the Scottish Government, because if they're not persuaded, then this goes nowhere. Right. But if they are persuaded, it might go somewhere.
Okay. Are colleagues content that we proceed on that basis? We are. Our second continued petition is petition 1933 to allow the Farnethy survivors to access Scotland's redress scheme. This was lodged by Iris Tinto on behalf of the Farnethy Survivors Group. I think we may have some within us in the gallery again this morning. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to widen access to Scotland's redress scheme to allow Farnethy survivors to seek redress. We last considered this petition at our previous meeting on the 12th of June, when we then heard evidence from the Chair and Chief Executive of Redress Scotland about their processes for considering applications for redress. And we've subsequently received further submissions from the petitioner sharing their reflections on the evidence from Redress Scotland, as well as commenting on recent submissions from Thomson's solicitors, the Law Society of Scotland and the First Minister. The petitioner's second submission provides further detail to support their view that Farnethy House operated as a residential school, including reference material about bursaries from the Glasgow Education Department for Farnethy House. So, I think we've now heard a lot of evidence. I think the committee is very clear on the direction of travel as far as we are concerned. Do colleagues have any suggestions as to how we might proceed? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. In light of the evidence we've heard, I wonder if a committee would write to the Deputy First Minister to set out the committee's view that individuals who experienced abuse in a relevant care setting should be able to access a redress scheme, regardless of the length of their stay or whether it was a parental consent for replacement. The committee may wish to highlight Thomson's solicitor's view that the way in which exclusion have been introduced and applied are inconsistent with the principles of dignity, respect and compassion, which are supposed to underpin this legislation. Also, the Scottish Government should review the Redress for Survivors Historic Child Abuse and Care Scotland Act 2021 and consult on expanding the scheme to include residential institutions that are owned and operated by the state, regardless of the length of their stay. Enable redress to provide where the abuse was carried out in such institutions by staff employed by the state, regardless of whether parental consent had been provided for a child to be placed there. The committee also recommends that the Scottish Government introduces a feedback mechanism to improve the collaboration between the Government's Redress Unit and Redress Scotland, enabling Redress Scotland to flag any issue or concerns that they have about the process.
Thank you. So I think, colleagues, following the various discussions we've had, we are very persuaded by the important considerations underlying this petition. This will be the unanimous and, notwithstanding the evidence we've heard from ministers before, very clear directed recommendation of this committee that the government act in accordance with the recommendations we are making. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I entirely agree with the recommendations that Mr. Torrance has set out and with your remarks. And it does seem to me that amongst us and five members of this committee, there's complete unanimity that this is an extremely strong case. There's a just grievance that must be corrected. And I wonder if it could be indicated, in addition to what Mr. Torrance has said in the letter to the Scottish Government, that this is an issue about which the committee was unanimous. We feel very strongly. And if need be, we would press for a debate in the Scottish Parliament, should that prove necessary, if the Scottish Government is not willing to do the necessary.
Yes, I'm content to agree to that too. Now, we're obviously about to go into summer recess, so we will, I think, confirm the wording of the final draft of our letter by correspondence And I just wonder whether colleagues, in view of that, would also be content that, you know, any correspondence once agreed is published on the petition webpage and you delegate to me as convener arrangements for publication to ensure that we not only send a letter to the government, but that we make a public statement to the effect of the conclusions that the committee has reached and the very firm recommended direction that the committee is urging the government to follow. Are colleagues content to do that? Yeah. We are. Thank you. Well, let's hope that that makes progress. I mean, it is quite unusual for the committee to issue very specific recommendations in this way. And I think, the government really ought to pay some attention, given the evidence we've heard, to the recommendations that we make. And I hope we're able to make progress on this petition on behalf of the petitioners accordingly. Mr. Chowdhury.
Can you also include the letter from the Law Society and Thomson Solicitor to the government as an evidence?
Well, I think we plan to highlight that within the context of the letter we're drafting. We'll obviously be drafting a comprehensive letter that will be drawing from those particular sources, and I think that's the important way to manage matters. Fine. That brings us on to Petition 1966 to formally recognise and incorporate local knowledge in Scottish Government policy. This has been lodged by the Scottish Gamekeepers Association. We last considered this in September last year. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to formally recognise local knowledge and ensure it is given full consideration alongside scientific knowledge throughout consultation, decision-making processes and in policy development, specifically within the conservation area. Arena, we last considered it, as I said, in September, on the 20th September 23, and agreed to write to the Scottish Government and Nature Scott. The Scottish Government's response to the committee states that there are no plans to revise the best practice handbook and consultations, and that it does not take a one-size-fits-all approach to consultations. Nature Scott recognises that local knowledge is vital and seeks to incorporate local knowledge in its work and decision-making in a number of ways, details of which are provided in the papers of this meeting. The submission also states that Nature Scott employs staff from a variety of areas and backgrounds who bring local knowledge to their roles. Well, that's what they say anyway. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrens.
I wonder if a committee, in light of evidence that we've been given, would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government and Nature Scott have set out their approaches in incorporating local knowledge in policy and decision making. And neither the Scottish Government nor Nature Scott currently intends to revise such approaches in line with the ask of a petition.
Thank you, Mr. Torrens. Mr. Ewing.
Well, I can't demur from the recommendation Mr. Torrens made. I mean, I don't really think this petition is going any further, but I could just say that, you know, I do personally feel from quite long experience that there is some substance behind the specific concerns that they highlight, specific examples that quangos do not take account of local people's views. And I'm afraid that I reached that conclusion a long, long time ago. Nothing has happened to make me change that. So I just wanted to put that in the record, convener, because I think the wording of the petition makes it difficult to see how local knowledge itself could be the subject of mandatory duties and legislation. It's maybe a bit vague, but the examples they gave of where that is felt that the state is not really interested in what the little man, the little person in rural Scotland says, I think are well-founded, and no doubt we will come back and consider some of these in future times. And of course, the SG are quite entitled to bring forward petitions on these specific matters, should they so choose.
Yes, Mr.
Ewing.
I'm
a member of the SGA. I think I've paid my subscription anyway.
Mr. Ewing, I'm similarly minded. I don't close this petition or accept Mr. Torrance's recommendation with any great satisfaction, but the direction in terms of the responses we've received is such that I don't think at this stage there's anything more we can do to take it forward. But am I persuaded by the assurances that we've received? I won't go so far as to say no, but I certainly, on the basis of the evidence I've heard in relation to other petitions in recent times, I'm not entirely persuaded. I think that would be the position. But are members, nonetheless, colleagues, content that we close this petition? And so we thank the Scottish Gamekeepers Association for bringing forward this petition. I'm sure that in, as other petitions can be raised again in the future, I very much fear some of the issues that have been identified here will not be resolved and may yet be the subject of future petitions again. Petition number 1986 to provide testing kits for drugs in public spaces. This has been lodged by Andy Patterson on behalf of the Help Not Harm campaign, last considered in October 23, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide free testing kits for drugs in public spaces, such as local pharmacies, libraries and university buildings. The Scottish Government's response to our correspondent reiterates that self-testing drug checking kits do not offer the same in-depth analysis and harm reduction advice that is offered by drug checking facilities. And the submission also details the progress being made now towards piloting drug checking facilities in Aberdeen, Dundee and Glasgow. The Scottish Government received more information from the Home Office about controlled drug licence applications for each area and anticipated that applications would soon be made. In consequence, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Convener. I would suggest that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that self-testing kits do not give as much information as lab analysis and may not indicate the presence of other substances or indicate the purity of drugs, and test results could be misrepresented or misinterpreted by individuals. Furthermore, the Scottish Government suggests that testing in drug-checking facilities is preferable, as harm reduction advice and signposting to support services can be offered. And finally, work has been progressed to pilot drug-checking facilities in Aberdeen, Dundee and Glasgow.
Colleagues, in light of the Scottish Government's responses, Mr. Golden's recommendation summarises those. Are we content?
Agreed.
We are. So we thank the petitioner for bringing forward the petition and hope very much that the progress that is being identified by the Scottish Government is in fact realised in the months ahead. Petition number 2025 to improve the support available to victims of domestic violence who have been forced to flee their home, lodged by Bernadette Foley. And forgive me, colleagues, quite a long follow-up given information we've received. But the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve the support available to victims of domestic violence who have been forced to flee the marital home by ensuring access to legal aid for divorce proceedings where domestic violence is a contributing factor. Ensuring victims are financially compensated for loss of the marital home, including loss of personal possessions and furniture left in the property, and ensuring that victims are consulted before any charges are made to changes are made to non-harassment orders. Now, we previously considered the petition at the on the 6th of September 2023, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Women's Aid, the Scottish Women's Rights Centre, the Law Society of Scotland, the Scottish Law Commission and the Scottish Government. And members will have noted from our papers that we've received responses from all of these organisations. The Scottish Law Commission have told us that while their Aspects of Family Law project does not extend to divorce law or legal aid, it will consider whether and how survivors of domestic abuse might be able to obtain remedies against perpetrators, including the loss of property. The Commission is also reviewing the efficacy of non-harassment orders. The Law Society suggests that making legal aid automatically available to anyone alleging domestic abuse could potentially open the scheme up to misuse. The response also indicates support for a victim being heard prior to any decision being taken to vary or revoke a non-harassment order, highlighting that this should happen automatically in a civil context, as the order would normally have been sought by the victim. The Scottish Government's response notes that in addition to an implementation board, an operational working group has also been established to work through the detail of how the Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act 2021 could operate. The response also notes there are several challenges to be addressed in implementing Part 1 of the Act, which gives powers to Police Scotland to issue a domestic abuse protection notice and apply to civil courts for a domestic abuse protection order. Responses from the Scottish Women's Rights Centre and Scottish Women's Aid indicate support for the aims of the petition and draw our attention to the increase in the number of victims self-representing due to the lack of available legal aid. And members may recall from previous considerations and petitions related to legal aid that the government indicated its intention to bring forward the Legal Aid Reform Scotland Bill during this Parliament, but we have not yet seen that. Do members have any comments for action? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if we could write to Minister for Victims and Community Safety, highlighting the evidence the committee has received and seeking an update on the work of Implementation Board and Operational Working Group to progress implementation of Part 1 of Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act 2021, including information on what challenges are still to be resolved before implementation can proceed, and to ask what action has been taken to ensure victims have the opportunity to be heard before non-harassment orders are varied or revoked, and whether the Scottish Government still intends to introduce the Legal Aid Reform Scotland Bill during this Parliament.
Particularly that last point, because this Parliament's running out of time to progress bills that would do such a thing. Colleagues, are we content? We are. Petition number 2037 to improve literacy attainment through research-formed reading instruction, lodged by Anne Glennie. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide national guidance, support and professional learning for teachers in research-informed reading instruction, specifically systematic synthetic phonics, to ensure teacher training institutions train new teachers in research-informed reading instruction, specifically systematic synthetic phonics. And we previously considered this petition on the 25th of October. At that time, we agreed to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills and to the General Teaching Council for Scotland. The response from the Cabinet Secretary notes that student teachers are taught about systematic synthetic phonics as part of broader understanding of the development and teaching of reading. The General Teaching Council for Scotland note, while it sets the required design, expected component parts and other features of the initial teacher education, such programmes do not aim to cover every teaching approach in detail. Their response also provides detail on the standards expected for teachers to maintain full registration, as well as ongoing efforts to develop a more effective career-long teacher education model. Now, we've also received two submissions from the petitioner, the first of which asks for more detail on what exactly is being taught to pre-service teachers and notes that research is being undertaken by academics in Glasgow and Dundee to evaluate current literary teaching practices. In her most recent submission, the petitioner draws our attention to international examples in Australia and New Zealand, with systematic synthetic phonics being recommended as the most effective method to teach children to read. The petitioner has also drawn our attention to a report exploring the variability in literacy rates and policy in both the UK and Ireland. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance, is you going to get your head around the tongue twister here?
I'm going to try. If a committee would like to close a petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Council of Deans of Education response to Cabinet Secretary states that students, teachers are taught about systematic phonics with a broader understanding of the development and teaching of reading. Education Scotland are developing new resources related to early reading, part of which will outline how systematic phonics approaches from one aspect of an overall of early reading. Don't ask me to say that again.
No, it's a serious issue, but I mean, I have to say there are a lot of systemic phonics appearing in our words there. But yeah, I mean, there does appear to have been a degree of action. I mean, the petitioner obviously isn't altogether sure of what all this is, but our colleagues prepared to act on. I wonder if we might close the petition, but nonetheless, in closing the petition, write to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, letting her know that we've closed the petition, but nonetheless drawing her attention to the fact that the petitioner feels that some of that work is a little vague, and maybe just follow it through in that regard. And that brings us to agenda item 3, which is the consideration of new petitions. And for those who are joining us this morning online, perhaps to hear their petition considered, can I say that ahead of that consideration, we always invite the Scottish Government to give us an initial view, and also the Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, to give the committee a view on the petition. And we do that because historically, before we did that as standard practice, that would be what we first decided to do at each consideration of the petition, so it just added a degree of delay. So the first of our petitions this morning, new petitions, is petition number 2092 to change the law and prevent children aged 5 to 17 from drinking alcohol in their home or other private premises. And this has been lodged by Jamie Lee Dougal, and it calls on the Parliament to do exactly what I've just said. The petitioner notes the issues Scotland has with many adults abusing alcohol and suggests that allowing children and young people to consume alcohol in the home or private premises does not help tackle these issues. The SPICE briefing provides detail of existing legislation restricting the sale and supply of alcohol to persons under 18. While there are no specific offences related to allowing consumption of alcohol in the home by a child, an adult could be prosecuted depending on the circumstances and the grounds of child cruelty under Section 12 of the Children and Young Persons Scotland Act 1937. In its response to the petition, the Scottish Government states that an alcohol-free childhood is the healthiest and best option and points to a downward trend in the levels of young people consuming alcohol. The response also notes that where a child has misused alcohol, this could be grounds for referral to the children's hearing system. Given the wide range of law, duties and public bodies and national guidance that is in place to protect children from harm, the government do not intend to take forward the specific ask of this petition, but have stated that the issue will be kept under review to assess whether further legislative measures may be required in future. Do colleagues have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Golden.
I think that we've attempted to progress this as far as possible, but ultimately I would recommend that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government does not intend to take forward the specific proposal contained in this petition at this time, given the wide range of law, duties on public bodies and national guidance that exists to protect children from harm, including that caused by alcohol.
Okay, our colleagues agree. Consent in that regard. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2093, to review and update the Scottish Ministerial Code. Can I just say, colleagues, I may make reference in summing up the petition to colleagues to active cases, which we should be circumspect about making any further comment. This petition is lodged by Benjamin Harrop and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review and update the Scottish Ministerial Code to put the code under statute to enable the independent advisers, to IAs, to initiate investigations. And if the First Minister decides to go against the IA's advice, a statement should be provided to Parliament to set out the sanctions for breaches other than misleading Parliament, to allow IAs to make recommendations for changes to the code, renaming the IA position to make it clear there is no judicial involvement, and require ministers to make a public oath of commitment to abide by the code. Now, the petitioner believes that updating the ministerial code through such changes would strengthen public standards and improve public confidence. Members will be aware, as noted in the SPICE briefing, that new versions of the ministerial code can be issued at any time, with previous updates having been issued following Scottish Parliament elections and changes of First Minister. The Scottish Government response highlights that the Ministerial Code was last updated in July 2023 to further strengthen transparency and propriety, and there are no current plans to update the Code during the remainder of this Parliament. It is perhaps worth noting that the Scottish Government response was provided prior to John Swinney being appointed First Minister. We've also received two written submissions from the petitioner, which set out in more detail how he believes the Ministerial Code should be updated to help provide public trust and transparency when applying the Code and investigating potential breaches of the Code. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to First Minister to highlight the petitioner's submissions, seek clarification on what consideration he has given to updating the Ministerial Code since taking office, ask him to set out a process for appointment the independent advisers on the Ministerial Code, including whether any consideration is given to how long they should remain in post.
Okay, so colleagues, we will keep this petition open and we will write to the First Minister on the term within the terms suggested by Mr. Torrance. Are we content to do that? We are. Thank you. That brings us to the last of this morning's new petitions, which is petition number 2096 to review the council tax system. And this has been lodged by Eleanor Fraser. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to start a review into the council tax system to consider whether rates could be set per capita rather than by property values. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that Scottish ministers have pursued various means to identify an alternative to the council tax system and highlights the work of the Joint Working Group on sources of local government funding and council tax reform. The submission states that the group is progressing the second phase of its work, which focuses on longer-term reform. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee, in light of the responses that we have had, would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government is undertaking work to consider long-term reform of local taxation as set out in its 2021 programme for government.
Are colleagues content? I mean, I doubt very much can happen in this Parliament now, even if there is work being taken forward. We have only 18 months of the Parliament left to run, but nonetheless, the government's view is that it's still undertaking this work, so are we content to close the petition? We are. And in which case, that now concludes the public part of our meeting, and we will meet again after the summer recess, and we now move into private session.